Sapphire's HyperPull and HyperPush are two of my favourite transitions, and the reason's simple. They're fast, dynamic, and flexible. In this tutorial, we're going to dive deep and show you how to create smooth, modern transitions with Sapphire. Okay, so here we are in Adobe Premiere Pro. But what I'm going to show you is going to be basically the same, no matter what host you're going to be working in. Even though we're going to be looking at HyperPull and HyperPush in this tutorial, I'm going to be accessing it through Sapphire's Transition Builder. So let's just come into our working timeline. And I'm going to come into my video transitions, and under Sapphire Builder, we have S Transition. The way that we use S transition is usually when we're wanting to build up a transition made up of several effects. But here, I'm just going to use it to make sure that we are as host agnostic as possible. So once I've got my S transition applied to my first cut, I'm going to go into Edit Effect, and we're going to go into the Effect Builder. And we're going to come down to Other, and I'm going to start with HyperPush. And let's just play this back. And what HyperPush is going to do is it's going to push me from our clip A, our from clip, into our clip B, our to clip. And it's going to do that with a number of different effects. And whenever we're looking at a new effect, I'd always recommend looking at our presets. So go to Load Preset, and this will open up the preset browser. And here we can be playing through any preset that we have available for this effect. And already, just by playing through some of these, you can see there's actually a very wide range of what we can do. Okay, I'm going to pause that for a second because I'm getting a little bit dizzy. And I'm going to start off with nice and clean because I want to do a bit of experimentation myself. And if we have a look in the nice and clean description, it's a basic starting point for experimentation. Thank you very much, Brian. So if I play this through, we have a fairly straightforward use of HyperPush. Now let's take a second to look at the controls, because HyperPush and HyperPull are made up of different modules, which we can see here. I'll just close up some of these so we can see these a bit better. And I'll come to my midpoint here, and I can turn off things like motion blur, so we can't see motion blur anymore. We don't have any glows turned on, we don't have any chroma turned on, and we don't have any distortion either. So the only thing that's really happening is our push. And what's controlling this is push through. And we have two areas to do, push through from and push through to. So if I set my Z distance to 1 and 1 in both of these, when I hit play, it's really just a very quick dissolve going through. I say very quick dissolve, it's actually really just a single frame dissolve here. And I'm going to save this out as another preset. I'm going to just call this one Full Reset. And I'll just fill in a little description, completely resets the effect to a base starting point. And this is going to be where I'm going to be doing all of my experimentation from. So with this first example, what I want to do is I want to do a seamless push through. So this means I'm going to try and match in the Z distance from and the center XY from and my Z distance too, and my center XY as well. So I'm mainly interested in these two girls here and trying to get a bit of movement between those. So we get almost like a match cut between these two. And the Z distance too, I'm going to push this one in a positive direction. So I'm going to make this greater than 1. So that we carry on a nice bit of movement, and the Z distance from, I'm going to make this less than 1. So we not only match these shots together, but we also start to match the pacing of the shots as we move through. So we've got a nice push. Followed by an almost match cut. And I can even do things like changing up the rotation as well, just to get that matching in. I don't need to make this 100% perfect, because as the movement goes through, this is going to hide the cut point very nicely for us. So let's stop that for a second, come back into my cut point, And the last thing I'm going to do is just add a little bit of motion blur. So if I turn motion blur back on, like the defaults that we had from our old preset were a bit high. So we'll reset those actually to 1 and 1. And I'm just going to push these a little bit down. So maybe 0.05 down. So just a really small amount. And that should be enough to give us that sense of movement as we cut through. Yeah, I think that works quite nicely. So I'm going to hit OK on that. And back in our host, our default transition length is probably a little bit too long there. So I'm going to take that to maybe, let's take that to 16 frames. That's quite nice. And this is sort of doing a linear move almost between the two. So one of the last things that we can do is change that up by changing the slow in and slow out. So I'm just going to take my slow out to 1. And that means that we're going to hit that out point just a little bit faster on the other end. So maybe not take that to 1, maybe I take that to 0.5. Take it halfway through. And let's play that through. Yeah. I like that. So it's not linear anymore. We've got a little bit of a acceleration curve on it. So that's a straightforward way that we can get a more interesting match cut. But there's obviously other things we can do as well. Let's come to our second cut point. I'll make sure we're working in S transition again. And we'll change our transition type to, we'll keep it on hyper push one more time. And this time I'm going to load up a preset and it's going to be my full reset preset. Full reset preset. Love it. I'm going to put my spin on a dip to black. I'm going to come a frame before the middle. And we'll close up all of the parameters we're not using. And I want to turn on glow darks. And this is a slightly underused effect in my opinion. Because whereas we have glow brights, which works like a traditional glow, taking the brightest parts of the image and making them brighter, glow dark sort of does the opposite. So we've got a threshold, and that tells us where we're going to be starting to glow from. So the lower we have this, the more closer we are aligned to the shadows. We have a darkness, which is how dark these areas are going to be. And we have our dark width. So that controls how wide that dark glow is. And on the slider, we just take it to between 0 and 2. But by scrubbing the number and holding down shift as well to make that number go faster, I can get that well beyond 2. So if we play that back now, we get a darkness that starts to envelop the first clip and then open up again through the second clip. And if you don't want it going quite as dark as that, so you want to have like just a hint, maybe we'll take that into the center cut point, and I'm just going to tweak my darkness until we're just about dark, but not entirely black. Cool. All right. I like that. So now we've got our not quite dip to black happening. Let's use the hyper push to actually do the push in now. So I'll turn off my glow darks for a second so we can see what's happening. And I'm going to come back in to my push through from and my push through to. And this time I'm not going to do big distance changes with my dissolve from and dissolve to. Maybe I'll take that just to 0.9 or something, just like a little change. Because most of the movement I'm going to take from my center XY. So I'm going to push this downwards. And I'll do the same on the other side, so the push through 2, because we need a little bit of change in the Z distance to get any sort of movement going. But then I'll change my center XY as well. Now, here's the thing. Up till now, we've done opposites on these push through and push from. So where the Z distance from has gone down, we've taken the Z distance to up. if we did the same thing with the center XY, so the center XY here has gone up to 5. If we took this down opposite, let's take a look at what that's going to what's going to happen there. It's going to push that down and then bounce the next clip up. So that goes down, this clip goes up. This could be what you want. Give a little bit of a bounce. I kind of like that, but not for now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to match these two up. So I'm going to say center XY from goes to 5.45 and center XY to also goes to 5.45. And let's see what happens there. So now we've got a continuation of that movement down. Okay, so let's add back in those glow darks. Ooh. That's starting to look like something. Let's add in a little bit of rotation. So get to the center point. I'm going to rotate from in a positive way. Let's take that to positive 10. And rotate two. Well, if we want to keep the motion here, this goes in a negative direction. So this is the reason I'm showing you this. So you see it's continuing on that movement there. I think that might be a little bit too much rotation. I'm going to take this all the way down to 3 and negative 3 on the opposite side. And I think that's going to work out a bit better. Yep, turn my glow darks back on. Cool, liking that. Final thing, always add in a bit of motion blur. Remember, I've saved my motion blur with too high a value. So we'll sort that out. Cool, I'm liking that. Let's hit OK on that. And let's play that back. Nice. So for this final cut, I want to have a look at the hyper pull instead of push, but we're going to start in the same basic place. And remember, I could just be using the hyper pull and hyper push directly in the timeline, but I'm keeping myself host agnostic because all of the things I'm doing with hyper pull and hyper push are cross platform and cross host compatible. So the hyperpull is very much the sister effect to hyperpush. So instead of going forward into the frame, we're pulling out away from the frame. And if we take a look at the presets, these look a little bit familiar. Yeah, we have pretty much the same presets going for hyperpull and hyperpush. They're just going in the opposite direction. So let's start with nice and clean as we did in the first example. I'll turn off motion blur. I'm going to take my dissolve speed as high as it will go. So we only get one frame of dissolve. If I take this really low, actually, this is a good chance to show you this. Yeah, if I take the dissolve speed really low, we get a very smooth dissolve happening between the two. Now, this could be something you want. And we could use this to hide the fact that we're doing a big cut, but you know, these are quite extreme, so I want a nice fast dissolve speed. I'm taking that all the way up to 5. They say all the way up, but like we've seen before, I can go higher if I just scrub in the numbers or if I just type in another number like 10. But with this length of transition, we're basically going to get one frame of dissolve, whether we're working at a dissolve speed of 5 or 10. Doesn't make a difference. Now, before we get into matching up anything, I'm just going to close all these down and I'm going to come right down to the bottom and take warp chroma down to 0. I'm going to take my distortion down to 0 as well. We're going to come back to these. And I'm just going to match up these clips again. So I'm going to take my Z distance, make that bigger, and make my Z distance 2 smaller and change the center XY so that we're matching those in pretty much. Because we've got the wrap set to reflect, you just got to be sure you're matching into the right reflection. In this case, I am. There we go. Now, instead of having this a simple sort of warp through, I can come down and add a little bit of camera shake to this. So we've got a camera shake module. I'll just turn that on. And we've got things like amplitude and frequency here. So we can match that through. Let's play that back. This is very much an interactive area there, but you can see just with a little bit in, I'm getting a little bit of a shake happening as it's making that move through. So we get a bit more of a natural movement. There we go. The next thing we're going to do is we'll come down and we'll have a look at the distortion again. Let's bring that up a little bit there. What I find that if we're adding distortion at this point, I might want to adjust the X and the Y and the Z to get that matching back in again. And we also have a distort RGB amount. So this helps to sort of distort things in a slightly more stylized kind of way, if that's what we want. I might add a touch in here. I don't want to go completely wobbly. I'll just add a little touch just to see how that works out. Let's play that through. And I actually really like that color separation that we're getting with the distort RGB. So let's just turn on warp chroma. And let's come to the frame just before the center, and I'm going to warp that up a little bit. You see that's adding a bit of chromatic aberration for me right here. I kind of like that. Let's turn warp chroma off and on. I like what that's doing. In fact, I like that a huge amount. And let's just play that back. Yeah, I like the sense of movement we're getting with that. And maybe let's touch the brightness up. Maybe not quite that far, just so we get a little bit of a brightness bump as it's going through. Yeah, I'm liking that. Adds a little bit more sort of dynamism to the whole thing. And of course, the final thing, bit of motion blur. Not that much motion blur. Remember, we set these to one on the blur to and from. We can sort of control this a little bit more. So I'm going to go up with my motion blur here. Maybe just rotate and go down a little bit with the blur too. So let's hit OK on that. And then we have three different versions of the HyperPull and the HyperPush made really, really quickly. These are two of my favorite transitions because they are just so flexible. We can get a huge variety of different looks out of these just by experimenting a little bit with the different modules. Remember, of course, you don't have to use every single module in every single effect. In fact, it can help just to theme things just a little bit, simplify it. And that's the beauty of Sapphire's HyperPull and HyperPush. My name is Ben Brownlee for Boris Effects, and I'll see you again in another Sapphire tutorial very soon. Bye for now. If you'd like to learn more about HyperPull, HyperPush, or any of the Sapphire effects, join us over at borisfx.com, where you have access to hours of free training, plus be able to download a free trial of any of the Boris Effects products.